welcome everyone to this crucial conversation. It's hard to believe we're in February now. We've been at this since September. And so we've moved along in talking about covenant, hearing the stories of people's lives and ministry. And so today we will talk about change and how to be the people we're called to be. So to begin with, Bailey Ziegler, who is the Diocesan Director for Human Resources in the Diocese of St. Cloud, will preside at prayer for us, and we're grateful. We have four partners in this process: the Diocese of St. Cloud, the FIP, AGPIM, and NAM, who have been great partners in conversation and supporting this initiative. So Bailey will preside, and then she will introduce Kerry to us, and then we'll move into, just so you know, we're going after Kerry talks, and she's got some great wisdom for us, is we'll go into breakout rooms and have some conversations and come back. So Bailey?
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us, like God's field, open our hearts to welcome the grace of this time.
We open ourselves to the planting and harvesting of the vineyard of the Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Hear now the encouraging words of Pope John the 23rd, taken from his 1962 speech to those who gathered in hope, awaiting the opening of the Second Vatican Council.
The fire of the Holy Spirit, the fire of Christ, is never one that devours, nor a destructive one. It's a quiet fire, a small flame of goodness and truth, that transforms with its light and warmth. We have seen that the Lord doesn't forget us. Even today, his way is humble. The Lord is present. He gives warmth to our hearts, shows us life, creates charisms of goodness and charity that shine in our world, which are for us a guarantee of the goodness of God.
Spiritus, Spiritu, envia tua Spiritu, envia tua Spiritu, sea renovado. La paz y la tierra sea renovada. La paz y la tierra.
A reading from the book of Revelation. And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also, he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." The word of the Lord.
Let us turn in prayer to Spirit of God, sent by the one who makes all things new. Spirit, things can seem so unsettled and unstable, and yet the story reminds us to hope for the future. Help us to see possibilities. Help us to be people of hope. Help us to live out your hope and justice. Spirit, teach us to sing your praise.
Spirit, through wise ones of old, you show us a vision of what could be. Through mystics and prophets of today, you challenge our vision of the present. Remind us of that vision of peace and justice. Empower us to live as if we believed it was really possible.
Spirit, teach us to sing with notes formed by
hopes and acts of justice.
Spirit, today there are many who wonder where their next meal will come from, many who look for work and income, many who look for meaning in a life in the face of life's disappointments, many who are isolated, ill, or dying because of a disease we struggle to control. Heal your world and make us partners in that healing.
Spirit, teach us to sing with harmony shaped by mercy's wide embrace.
Spirit, we recall the promise you revealed to Julian of Norwich. All will be well, all will be well, all manner of things will be well. Sometimes we doubt your promise. When our despair grows and threatens to overcome the light, give us hope. When we are tempted to find relief from the present, trying to recreate the past, call us to be people of the future. When life's music has faded and become a funeral drudge.
Spirit, teach us and all the earth to join the chorus and dance to your beating heart.
Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Pour forth your spirit, and they shall be created.
And you shall renew the face of the earth.
Let us pray. O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit did instruct the hearts of the faithful, grant us in the same spirit to be truly wise and ever to rejoice in your consolation. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Envia tua spiritu, envia tua spiritu, envia tua spiritu, sea renovada. La paz y la tierra sea renovada. La paz y la tierra.
Okay. Thank you, everybody, for participating in our opening prayer. Like Barbara said at the beginning, my name is Bailey Ziegler. I'm one of the partners on this project through my role with the Diocese of St. Cloud, where I serve in human resources ministry. And I am very excited and honored to introduce our speaker for today. She's somebody I have admired in ministry for many years, and every chance I've gotten to hear her speak or read her writing, I'm continually inspired and grateful for her and other lay ministers, especially women who are paving the way for those of us who are newer in our ministries. So I'm just grateful that you're here with us today, Kerry, and looking forward to your presentation. So Kerry Alys Robinson is the Global Ambassador of the Leadership Roundtable and author of Imagining Abundance, Fundraising, Philanthropy, and a Spiritual Call to Service, which if you haven't read, you should read immediately after this webinar. Kerry is a member of the Raskob Foundation for Catholic Activities and the foundations and donors interested in Catholic activities. She has served on the boards of many diverse apostolates, including the Jesuit Volunteer Corps, St. Thomas More Catholic Chapel and Center at Yale, America Media, and the USCCB's Catholic Campaign for Human Development. She is a fierce advocate for the role of laity, young adults, and women in service to the church. And she and her husband, Dr. Michael Cappello, have two children, Christopher and Sophie. So, Kerry, I hand it over to you.
Thank you so much, Bailey. I work with a friend and admirer of yours at Leadership Roundtable, Peter. And when I told him that I had the good fortune of being introduced by you today, he said without missing a beat that you were one of his favorite humans on the planet. So it is really wonderful to be with you and to be with all of you. I want to begin by sincerely thanking you for who you are and what you do, for all the ways you are a blessing to those to whom and with whom you minister. I want to thank you for your vocation of service and leadership. We don't say thank you enough, and I really want to begin by thanking you. And thank you also for prioritizing the themes and commitments taken up in this wonderful and life-giving series. I'm especially indebted and grateful to you, Barbara, for the invitation and for the covenant for a healthy ministerial workplace, I think of as a work of beauty and urgent importance. So I've structured my remarks to be brief and to encourage discussion at the end. First, just a quick background on me so you know the context out of which I speak, a word about the current reality we are all confronting collectively, globally. And then I'm going to speak very candidly and personally about my own work environment, my own Catholic institution, Leadership Roundtable. This talk has given me the chance to reflect on how we have adapted over these 10 months and how closely aligned or far from the mark we have been to the principles outlined in the covenant. We're committed to leading well and to offering a different model, that one that is predicated on co-responsibility. So the crisis of the pandemic and the invitation to take up some of these themes with you all has really been a blessing in that respect. And I'm going to conclude with maxims to live by, particularly as we are concerned about creating workspaces that are healthy, lives that are healthy, and calling the church to greater levels of mission effectiveness and health for its most valued assets, people. Okay, so my background. My background is in Catholic religious philanthropy. I was born to a family that now has a 76-year history of serving the church at the local, national, and international level through the instrument of a private family foundation called the Raskob Foundation for Catholic Activities. And this allowed nearly 100 of my relatives and me to grow up in this culture of philanthropy. When we are teenagers, we are invited to serve as volunteers in a non-remunerative way in the work of the foundation. The expectation is we will immerse ourselves in the life of the church, the better to anticipate unmet or undermet needs and make more judicious decisions about philanthropic investment. And it's really how I fell in love with the church. I was meeting women and men, ordained religious and lay, like you, who were living lives of breathtaking meaning and purpose. And despite confronting the worst of what humankind can do to one another and to our common home, the earth, you were always ministering with a freedom and a joy that I found breathtaking. And I want it to be like you. Raskob gave me this orientation to the church in its broad and deep forms of apostolates. But Raskob was also a founding member of FADICA, a network of other family foundations that were similarly investing in Catholic activities. And I was brought up in that extended philanthropic family. I just came from their annual meeting in Zoom. I switched rooms in the house to kind of switch it up, but I learned a lot through FADICA as well about generosity and the world of the church. And I would have been happy to make my entire life's work in the space of philanthropy, but 23 years ago when I was pregnant with my daughter, I was asked to move to the other side of the philanthropic coin and be the director of development for St. Thomas More, the Catholic Chapel and Center at Yale University. So suddenly I was thrust into the role of fundraiser. Halfway through our capital campaign on behalf of the Catholic Center at Yale, the sexual abuse revelations in 2002 revealed themselves. And that was devastating, of course, for all of us. It led Father Bob Beloyne, the Catholic chaplain at Yale, and me. We were modeling co-responsibility and modeling ordained lay partnership in ministry. And we were committed to answering students' questions about what had happened to our church. Our board, predominantly lay, did not want us to attend to it in any way. They said, you didn't cause this, you're not culpable, don't worry about it, just keep raising money for Catholic life at Yale. We thought that was fundamentally unfaithful, that the church, even this big institutional church, was nevertheless our faith family. And when your family is in crisis, you do everything you can to effect healing and reconciliation. You don't wait for the family to change before acting. And that was the attitude that we brought to it. So we convinced our board to let us suspend the campaign and to plan over 8 months a three-day conference called Governance, Accountability, and the Future of the Catholic Church, examining the underlying conditions that existed in the institution that allowed or contributed to this crisis. 3 months later, I met Jeff Wazzy. He is the founder of Leadership Roundtable. He persuaded me to be the founding executive director. And Leadership Roundtable, similarly, was created in order to attend to the managerial challenges in the church and is dedicated then and now to promoting best managerial practices, accountability, transparency, in the church, particularly in the areas of finance, management, human resource development, which is one of the reasons I am so indebted to Barbara and her team for putting on this series, as well as in the field of communications. So that's my background and upbringing. The church's explicitly religious mission has formed the woman that I am. That it is the largest global humanitarian network in the world renders me forever committed to its health and vitality. I will never give up on the church, no matter how much it can and has broken my heart at times. So Leadership Roundtable was born out of crisis, the sexual abuse crisis. There was a strong sense that to do nothing is to be complicit. And baptism confers both responsibilities and rights. And never has the church needed the leadership, the cooperation, the expertise, and the active engagement of the laity more. Now we are confronting a new crisis, although the impact of the abuse crisis and concomitant loss of trust in church leadership remains. Just because you have a pandemic doesn't mean all other crises evaporate. They are still there to be attended to. This current crisis of COVID-19 pandemic, the temporary closing of churches and church facilities, the concomitant economic distress, the fact that more is being asked of pastoral ministers, more is being asked of the church in a time of crisis than ever before. All of this is what you all are living on a daily basis, and we are deeply mindful of in our work with Leadership Roundtable. I'm married to an infectious disease doctor who's been on the front lines. what has been most heavily weighing on my heart for these 10 months is the individual and collective grief, the loss of employment, the financial anxiety for so many, deep inequities that the pandemic has exposed, the inability to be with our loved ones who are sick, who are dying, the restrictions on how we grieve communally, how we celebrate the lives of those we have lost. The toll all of this takes on pastoral ministers in particular is weighs on my heart every day. So now I want to speak very candidly about Leadership Roundtable. I do realize it's being recorded. All of this is said in the deepest love and respect for my colleagues. I probably should have checked it out with them before sharing it, but I thought it was important to concretize some of the observations and some of the wisdom that we have gleaned in this process. So in March of 2020, I had been in a whirlwind of work travel all over the globe. I was global ambassador for Leadership Roundtable. Now, this work travel in March included a conference on co-responsibility on the campus of the University of Notre Dame with Barbara Sutton. And after that, I still had, I think, two more work trips. So I was on the road when the country effectively went into lockdown. I was not yet back from my travels. I joined my colleagues at Leadership Roundtable about 1 week after the country went into lockdown. And after they had had at least somewhat of a chance to recalibrate to our new reality, our staff was suddenly spread out in remote offices from Canada to Louisiana and across multiple time zones. To be honest, I found it extremely hard to re-enter the space. We were already technically proficient in Zoom and had been accustomed to Zoom meetings, so that was one grace. But I felt like I was joining the team with no real way to process what was happening to us, to our families, to our communities. It felt like I was just being plunged into frenetic, urgent work. 1/4 of our team ended up with COVID, even though we were all in different states and we still have not been physically together in 10 months. Two senior staff people just before the lockdown had left for other opportunities. Another needed to take 2 months of medical leave and one had just begun parental leave. Meanwhile, there was a heightened, growing sense of urgency for our work. So when COVID-19 became a national crisis impacting the church, we jumped into action. One of the things that we did right off the bat was convene the top 16 leaders in the church in the U.S., the papal nuncio, the heads of women of the women's and men's religious communities, the CEO of the church's national public ministries like Catholic Health, Catholic Charities, NCEA, all the acronyms. We limited it to 20 of us so we could see each other on one screen, and we led the conversation about what they were experiencing in terms of urgency related to the pandemic, and we listened for common concerns so that then we could act on it. And for someone who used to travel more than she was home, I will safely say that being in lockdown in my home for 10 months during this pandemic, I've never worked harder. It's a curious phenomenon. But so a combination of events led to a remarkable insight. We could just buckle under the pressure of crisis, or we could try something new. In a way, crisis allows, it's an invitation to risk-taking or to innovation if you're bold enough to commit to that. And we really, there was just a combination of internal pressures and external pressures. And there was strategic thinking that was all positive that was part of the mix as well. And so this insight, this combination of factors, led us to the bold commitment to restructure ourselves and offer an alternative model of leadership and cooperation and care and mission effectiveness. We're just one Catholic organization, but we wanted to really model what we care deeply about. We wanted to model co-responsibility and advance a new culture of leadership and management. Crisis only sharpened the urgency for this. We eliminated the CEO position and created a partnership of that was an alternative to a hierarchical mindset. And we wanted to experience this ourselves and show the church an alternative that could issue in even greater mission effectiveness. So now we have five co-equal partners, each with our own portfolio, and all important decisions are made together, and those decisions are better because of it. We make sure no one partner or staff member ever is unduly burdened. Cooperation, not competition, is our ethos. And for me, being pulled back into the center as a partner required me to refamiliarize myself with our operations, programs, services, staff, et cetera. I had been the CEO for the first 11 years, had passed that role on to my successor for 4 years, was very happy as a global ambassador, kind of in my own satellite in orbit. But now I was being called into this intentional community of partnership. So my primary concern over these past 10 months in this new role was to ensure that the place of our employment would be a coveted, deeply congenial, rewarding, and fulfilling, healthy place to work for all who worked there. Working on morale, restoring morale, became my driving motivation. And you could pull anyone from my team or my board and say, what's Kerry's number one concern? And they're all clear about where I'm coming from on this. So we introduced some practices that have served us well toward changing our institutional culture to a more healthy culture. We took greater care in prayer. We had always incorporated prayer, of course, but we took much greater care of prioritizing it. We rotated the responsibility of leading the team in prayer among the full staff, allowing us to appreciate the rich diversity of ways of praying. As partners, we rotate the responsibility of sending an end of the week wrap up to the full team, noting the accomplishments, singling out people for their particular hard work, thanking our team members, and celebrating. We introduced prompts, some of these that begin every meeting following the prayer. Now, some are very lighthearted, some are more revealing. Questions like, tell us about an important teacher or mentor. What is a favorite present you have given or been given? What is a virtue that has served you well during the pandemic? What new appreciation about life do you have as a consequence of the pandemic, et cetera? And we would pass it to each member so everyone had a chance to speak. Now, sometimes, as I said, these were very simple, innocuous questions. I can't tell you how often it prompted laughter or tears or really raw emotion that seemed to me so healthy and so important. And normally we would just rush right into whatever our business agenda was. So we took the extra time, and I think it has served us so, so well. So some observations, not all of which have been gleaned in these 10 months, but over the course of my life. It may sound platitudinous, but there is no more meaningful path to a joyful life than gratitude. It's so easy. It is so easy to focus on what is lacking, on the imperfect, on the negative. It's so easy to be tempted by cynicism, to be genuinely anxious or resentful. to think that things cannot possibly change. But we don't have to succumb to a despairing worldview. We don't have to be co-opted by insidious cynicism or abandon our idealism or our hope in the future or our compassion in the face of another suffering. Those are choices we can make. I found that paying attention and being aware, being intentional about being present mattered, especially over these last 10 months. One thing I learned from my partnership and deep friendship with Father Bob, the Catholic chaplain at Yale, through the lens of his exceptional pastoral ministry and care, is that every single one of us is carrying something. What people carry is often extraordinarily heartbreaking and heavy, even if invisible. Mercy goes a long way. So I learned these truths and try to hold myself accountable to them and try to weave them into our very institutional practices and policies and ethos. Remember that you cannot protect yourself from sorrow without also protecting yourself from joy. Cultivate a merciful heart. As the Pope enjoins us, encounter people who are different than you, accompany people who are in far greater need than you. Let your heart break by this beautiful world and our common humanity. A good question to ask is, what breaks your heart? And what are you good at? Knowing the answers to these two questions and connecting those answers will set you on a life of meaning, purpose, and fulfillment. A friend told me of a profound exercise she undertook that radically transformed her life. She was asked to write her obituary if she were to die today. And then she was asked to write the obituary that she would be most proud of if she were to live beyond today. The comparison was revealing. At the end of your life, what would you like people to say about you, to know about you? Now, what do you have to do today and tomorrow and next week and next year to ensure that is your legacy? I've marveled my whole life at the tenacity of visionaries who work toward a more just, more merciful, and more charitable world. Now, I'm literally speaking to the choir. This is what you all do and who you are in the exercise of your ministry and pastoral care. It's an activity not for the faint of heart. To be committed is to be committed for the long haul. My best friend quips, if you need to see the immediate results of your work, paint houses. Imagine all that can be brought to fruition by leaders who possess this particular constellation of qualities, vision, courage, tenacity, and a radical commitment to making this a better, more just and joyous world. This is our inheritance as members of the Catholic faith community. Several years ago, the world was preparing for the birth of the 7 billionth person. I don't know if this got to your consciousness or if it registered, but it was a big deal in my neck of the woods. The world was waiting for the actual birth of the 7 billionth person. And my super creative and talented friend, Valerie, conceived of a global art installation centered on one question. What would you say to the 7 billionth person? The answers in a variety of media fell along a spectrum. Alarming, anxious prognostication about the dire state of the world into which this child would be born on one end, and heartfelt, hopeful joy for a child we have been waiting to welcome on the other. So the question is, where would your response fall? People of faith, people of goodwill, are instructed to bear joy and to bear witness to joy, even in the midst of oppression, suffering, poverty, and brokenheartedness. It's never facile joy, but joy that comes from faith, faith in God and faith in something larger than ourselves. It is a spiritual discipline to cultivate. faith that it is possible to make a meaningful difference in the lives of others, faith that it is possible to correct unjust structures, faith that it is possible to eliminate extreme poverty and inequality, faith that peace can be achieved, that reconciliation can be effected, that forgiveness can be extended, and that the common good can be prioritized. Here in the midst of communal and personal suffering, or how in the midst of communal and personal suffering can one access joy, let alone radiate it? It seems incongruous, if not impossible. I understand, therefore, why some of the submissions for my friend's art installation depicted scenes of violence, hunger, toxicity, human trafficking, genocide, division, conspiracy theories, acrimony, and the like, alerting the 7 billionth person to the kind of world she or he will find. Life does not have to be perfect for us to find reasons to be grateful, however. In the midst of tremendous suffering, there can be, and there always can be, found compassion, mercy, altruism, and love. Be aware of such grace and human kindness. It is everywhere, even and especially when there is concomitant human anguish and loss. I think all of us can testify to examples, small and large, over these past 10 months of the tiniest act of mercy or kindness that has just cracked open our hearts because of what we are carrying and what we are collectively going through. So rejoice in this. Gratitude begets gratitude, blessings multiply, and the fruit of the habit of gratitude is that soon one experiences blessing where before one experienced only lament. When we bear witness to joy, we offer hope to a broken world, and this world needs hope. So my favorite submissions centered on welcoming the 7 billionth person as a celebration of wonderful news with arms open, full of love. Welcome, you are the one we have been waiting for. We are so glad you have come. So to wrap up, I want to just offer these 10 maxims that are evocative of what I've said. A couple are I haven't yet mentioned. And I share these with you so that you can tell me whether they resonate, you can add your own valuable maxims, and that we can have a conversation both in our breakout rooms and when we come back together. So the first, most important, people first. People first. It's so easy for us in our work lives to plunge right into all of the work that awaits us personally and collectively. But remember, people first. Be a beneficial presence. Err on the side of compassion, kindness. Check in with one another. Commit to deep listening and care. This was something that I saw in the covenant over and over again, this emphasis on the importance of deep listening and care. So people come before work, processes, accomplishments, achievements. These prompts that I mentioned that we begin our meetings with on Zoom, sometimes it really is the most innocuous question, and yet it leads to deeper truths, revelations of the human heart. It's fostered community among our team and sometimes elicits in deep emotion, which we hold as sacred. It's always time well spent. Second is simply be grateful. Any practice that cultivates the deliberate discipline of gratitude, it will be well worth your time. Third, name what it is you most love about belonging to the Catholic Church. This is the best advice I can offer in times of anguish when the institutional church fails to live up to its potential or manifests ignoble qualities like clericalism, fear, secrecy, prejudice, or mediocrity. This best advice comes from my teacher and spiritual director, a beloved sister of mercy, Margaret Farley. She said years ago to me, and I've never forgotten it, remember what it is you most love about the church and membership in it. Name what you love, claim what you love, because it will provide ballast to allow you to navigate with fidelity and focus when you are disappointed and discouraged. I've taken this to heart and I highly recommend the discipline. Have you thought about this? When people ask you, why are you Catholic or why you stay, what do you tell them? What do you most value about our faith? My list is long and wide. I love our church's rich intellectual tradition, social justice teaching, sacramental life and imagination, mercy, the Eucharist, the primacy of conscience, prayer and transcendence, forgiveness, the preferential option for the poor and most vulnerable, the injunction to be Christ-like every day. I love that where there is human suffering, the church is always at the vanguard of providing relief, promoting justice, and advocating for peace. I love our church's appreciation of beauty and aesthetics, the art and architecture, music and literature our faith has inspired. I am daily grateful for Pope Francis. I love that he has given us Laudato Si, and that it provides people of goodwill a seminal roadmap to care for our common home and one another. And with the heartbreaking loss of my friend, Father Bob, the Catholic chaplain at Yale, who died 2.5 years ago of glioblastoma, with the heartbreaking loss of him, I'm grateful more than I can say for our church's articulation of the community of saints, the conviction of eternal life, the fact that love doesn't end in death. I know that there are as many personally held and valued reasons why one loves the church as there are members of the church. My advice is to be clear often about what it is you must most love and value, for that will sustain you in these times of challenge and difficulty and change. Fourth, go slow to go far. We are hardwired, it seems like, in this country to go fast, to cross things off the list, to get to the next task. It's important, and if anything we've learned in these 10 months, it's the importance of finding ways to replenish. Remain truthful and positive. Keep a perspective. Think about what needs to be done right now and what needs to be prepared for in the future. Fifth, cultivate joy. When I first started working with Father Bob, he gave me a beautiful plaque for Christmas that said, it can be done. And the next year for Christmas, it was my turn, and I gave him a beautiful plaque that said, it can be fun. I think joy is constitutive of of an adult, mature spiritual life. And particularly when it comes to fundraising, it is absolutely essential to be joyful. But I think it's important to be joyful in any meaningful pursuit. So notice and acknowledge even small details that bring you joy. One of my favorite expressions is, and we try to institutionalize this at Leadership Roundtable, celebrate what is right in order to find the energy to fix what is wrong. We should not shortchange our celebrations, our accomplishments, and the proper recognition of our colleagues. Sixth, communicate solutions, not only problems. I wish this was the ground rule for every single meeting I've ever been in. Communicate solutions, not only problems. There's so much more energy, positive, constructive energy in the solution space. Communicate with consistency and frequency. I think this is really a lesson for the institutional church when it was trying to figure out how to respond to crisis, particularly the abuse crisis. There was a lot of good wisdom there about how to communicate and how to be honest and who deserves to know the truth first and foremost, etc. Transparency is always our friend. assume nothing and explain everything is often a good principle, not just in campus ministry with 18 to 22 year olds. Seventh, be generous. I've spent most of my adult life working on behalf of the church in the space of philanthropy and fundraising. And I firmly believe that we are called to be generous, all of us, that we all have a capacity for generosity, and that we're called to be catalysts to inspire generosity in others. And generosity is not just about money. It's about extending the benefit of the doubt to others, presuming goodness in others, offering our time, being present. We are all called to be generous. I really firmly believe that generosity is humankind's birthright, and how we claim that and honor it is a measure of our fidelity to our faith. Eight, co-responsibility and diversity. I spend a lot of time talking about these two themes. One of the reasons I am such an advocate of women's role in the church is because of the truth behind this. Diversity really matters. When my children were little, when Christopher and Sophie were little kids, my husband and I told them that if we ever got lost or separated at a mall, in a park, at a museum, they were to go immediately to a mother with young children, and that she would know how to keep them safe until we could be quickly reunited. It's curious. I never said go to a cop. I never said go to a priest. I said go to a mother with young children that they could see. And it's not that women are smarter than men or that parents are more judicious than those who are without children, or that laity are more competent than the ordained. It's that diversity matters because we're all myopic. Every one of us on our own and in our narrowly defined groups are myopic. We only know what we know. If we are looking at the same object in the center of a table and we are around that table, we are all seeing what that object is. And you opposite me are able to round out the picture of what we are, the reality we are looking at. We make better decisions this way. It is really why I think it is a matter of moral and managerial urgency to insist that women are at the tables of decision-making along with men, and that we clear paths so that women can properly exercise leadership in the church along with men. Emulate what you advocate. This is number nine. Lead with core values, live out of core values, live out of mission in adaptable ways, be nimble, practice innovation and creativity. And 10th, be the reason for someone's hope each day. Deep within the Catholic imagination is the Paschal mystery, that out of suffering and death comes new life. This is our claim. This is our central faith claim. I heard it expressed at the beginning of the lockdown when we were entering Lent. We were in Lent. We are an Easter people in a Lenten lockdown. People of faith are called to be hopeful. We know this. We know this by what is central to our faith. So thank you for this opportunity to offer some of these reflections. Thank you really for the invitation to put so much thought into what it is I value most, what has proven effective in my own life, even when I come up short with achieving many of these things. Thank you for the opportunity. As I was preparing to meet with you all, you gave me the opportunity to help change the culture of my own organization and to commit and win their commitment to some of these great values that will ultimately issue in a healthier environment. So I really appreciate your time and attention and look forward to a discussion later in our program.
Thank you, Kerry, so, so much of being vulnerable. Yeah. Sharing your experience and way through something new and how it could work. I think what you've done for us is to really share a story of hope. You've asked us to slow down and look into each other's eyes and maybe know what color each other's eyes are before we start in with our to-do list and attaching everything we should have done, could have done, and to really see the people in front of us. So you really helped us picture it, and I can hear in your voice and your stories that you do your best to live it. Stories bind us. And so what we're going to do for our breakout rooms today is Tim Welch will pull up the breakout rooms, and I've taken Kerry's 10 maxims, and you're, I think, 5 or 6 people can go in a room. So you can select which maxim you want to go in. So you go in your breakout room, and what I want you to do and to think about is to share a story, how this maxim could be for you a change, or that you would be a change agent in your organization because of this maxim. And so part of it is, what would it be like for you to try it on, and or where has it worked? So to do some storytelling, because stories lift our emotions. Stories show us a way forward. So I'm going to leave you in these breakout rooms for 15 minutes. We'll come back and do some sharing, but I want to also leave some time for questions and answers with Kerry to continue to break this theme open. So you choose your breakout room, and bye-bye. I would like to take probably about 7 minutes to hear from the different maxim groups, someone from each, to kind of share a reaction to the maxim, a possibility, and a hope that you could see possible for you and being an agent of change. So maxim one. You may have to read that maxim out loud for me, too, because I don't have it in front of me.
It would be people first.
People first. Anyone from people first?
Well, I came from people first, and we decided that people should be first.
Wonderful.
So yeah, we did decide that, you know, we kind of talked a little bit about even Jesus did saying that, you know, we had to love each other, you know, as, you know, Christ loved the church, that kind of thing. I mean, that, well, Paul said that, but Jesus said that we had to love our neighbor as ourselves and things of that sort. So that I was just saying that, you know, once we do start to put people first, then of course the first thing that happens with that is that not only do we, you know, when we acknowledge them and see them and care about them, we change their lives, but then they go on and to change someone else's life. Because, you know, once you've done that for someone and they've been and they've been seen and they've been confirmed or that they've been held sacred, then they go out and they do the same for the next person as well. And so, you know, of course, what a beautiful church we would have if that's what the experience of its parishioners and its co-workers in the fields, if that's the level of experience we were being exposed to, that being seen, being acknowledged, being cherished, being, you know, all those things, I mean, we'd be a lot more empowered for sure. So, and it was just two of us. Yara, did you want to say something?
Okay, the second group would be gratitude.
Thank you, Doris.
You're welcome.
Maureen, do you want to say something?
Thanks, Marty.
I nominate you.
Well, I think to the extent we shared stories of gratitude, they often had to do with the witness of others in our lives, whether it be lay ministers, others who are ministering in the church who persevere and who do so much while suffering in many cases a good bit, but the kind of gratitude and joy that comes from being able to hear their witness, to see that. And then I think the other was that resonated for us in the overlaps among some of the maxims. But I know intentionality came up a couple times, because gratitude as a practice, and a practice that we intentionally cultivate, that it's not necessarily something that just comes to us, but that if we have practices, and I shared a story of somebody I know has this kind of practice, if we have practices for raising up gratitude, then that's going to make it more frequently experienced in our lives.
Thank you, Maureen. What's our third maxim?
It's belonging to the church.
Diana, would you be willing to be our spokesperson?
Yes, it's very little what I have to share. I say that the most thing I love about the church is the body of Christ, is the people, not what we do or we don't do, or what we have or we don't have in the church, but the people, the ones who you encounter. You don't ask if you're Catholic or not. You just put it as a body of Christ, and that's what I love the most, that we have that in our church, the body of Christ. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Diana. What's the next one, Tim?
It would be go slow and replenish.
Did anyone go slow?
Yeah, we're very slow here. We were two. One of the insights we have is, even if you have lots of deadlines and things that you have to meet, there still can be a slowness. We kind of focused on the preparation part. At the piece, it says, not just what needs to be done now, but what is for the future. So there's a lot of that, even in the midst of all of our schedules, that even if we're looking ahead and we feel disjointed, there's still an intentionality, as people have mentioned, and a thinking creatively and about people and what is that need for the future. And you do have to kind of slow down. It may take months of preparation for that, even though you have a deadline in the future about it, there's still some thoughtfulness and slowing down inside your process for it. So, and Christy shared some beautiful creative things that they're doing in that regard.
Thank you. One more maxim, and then we'll, if you have questions for Kerry and want to put them in the chat room, if you have them, we can sort them out. So what's our next maxim, Tim?
Cultivate joy.
Well, we were three, and we actually, we were struck by the part after that about celebrating what's right in order to address what's wrong, that gives us kind of the energy and the desire to, that being joyful can give us the energy and the desire that we need to do that. That it's easy during these times to kind of let the desire, the oomph get sucked out of us, but focusing on joy can help us do that. And then we talked about several things. We can't wait for the recording so we can really go over much more.
Yeah. Great. Well, thank you. Thank you for the maxim conversation. I want to move to see if there's some questions for Kerry. We're getting an immense amount of gratitude for you, Kerry. I've Christy Bivens from the Diocese of St. Cloud just sent a note. Thank you for bringing Kerry to us. So the question, this is from Jackie. Would you say there's a hierarchy to the maxims, or do you need one to have another? So are they interrelated, or where do you start?
That's a great question. I definitely think they're interrelated, but I think any one of them on its own is of value too. When I think about all of them, for me, the starting point is really gratitude. And I think that's because of my exposure to the church through the instrument of philanthropy, which led to fundraising, everything about that is starts and ends with gratitude. It's this awareness that everything we have been given is a gift from God, and that one's response to that is properly gratitude. Mm. When I met Henry Nouwen just before he died, I was pregnant with my first child, like really hugely visibly pregnant, you know, overdue. And he said to an audience of Catholic students, the central task in our lives is to really truly know that you are totally radically loved by God just for being you. And he said, we spend all of our adult lives avoiding that, not really believing it, talking ourselves out of that central claim, finding all the reasons why that can't possibly be. But every now and then we do know it. We feel it in this epiphany kind of way, that we are radically loved by God just for being who we are. And he says the response to that is one of profound gratitude. It's like being in love with someone and realizing that they love you back. Just an indescribable amount of gratitude and awe. And you want to love God back, but how do you love God back? Henry would say, by loving all that God loves, each other, the earth, creation. And that is how we love God back. And I was so struck by that and realized that tied up in all of that is just profound gratitude for the opportunity we get to even have conversations like this with wise, loving, intentional people.
Yeah.
Quick reference, one of Nouwen's buddies, Brother David Stendel Rast, has the book Gratitude, the Heart of Prayer. It's outstanding.
Mm. I'm watching time, and Kerry, do you have any last fervorinos for us? Or
I will end where I started, which is I'm so grateful to all of you. I know so many of you, and I've admired you and learned from you. I continue to learn from you. Your example means the world to me. It keeps me in the church, and it keeps me actively committed to change for the better. And just you'll be in my prayers. Bless you for all that you have done.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you, Kerry. And just as we end, is to really an immense amount of gratitude to the Diocese of St. Cloud and everyone who helped. It takes a village to get this Zoom thing going, and really to thank Bailey and Tim and Christy and Tony and all those people and Lori for really making today happen for this crucial conversation. And next month we're back together again, and we're gonna be reopening the covenant and the indicators for it. And so I'm seeing it more as a working meeting. So we've had different ways of doing it, but I think Vic is on here somewhere, want to work with firming up what it looks like to use the covenant and the indicators, and how might we implement it nationally as a way of enhancing our work life. So that's what we'll, so come with your sleeves rolled up, and because we want to talk about it, we want to do it, we want to be it. So that's the picture we want to paint. So I feel really good about what Kerry's done today, because in some way she's helped us turn a corner from lament to hope, you know, a paradigm shift of all that could be possible. And I know it's not without work, but to begin to see the paint drying on the wall, right, Kerry? Thanks for it really is an artistic expression, this kind of change that we hope for. So God bless and thank you.